Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Williamson County Sports Connection. I'm Jack Daniels, your host, and with me for today's show is the head baseball coach at Ravenwood High School, Coach Teddy Craig. Coach, welcome.
Thank you. Appreciate you having me.
Well, we had you here last year for the first time, but if you don't mind, would you kind of back up and tell us a little bit about, you know, where you were at before coming to Ravenwood High School?
Sure. I grew up in Winter Park, Florida, which is just outside of Orlando. Went to high school there at Winter Park High School and went to college at University of Arkansas, Little Rock. Moved back to Orlando, got married, and started my coaching career at West Orange High School and was there quite a while. And we made a family move several years back, and we chose Nashville, and very happy we made that decision.
Okay. So how many years you been in Nashville now?
This is my third year at Ravenwood.
Okay.
We have lived in Nashville for six.
Okay. All right. So when you came to Nashville, were you teaching, coaching at one of the school, another area school here?
At Davidson Academy.
Davidson Academy.
Yes.
All right. That's a little bit north of the Nashville community.
That's correct.
Right.
That's correct.
So were you living up in that area, or
no,
were you living down in this area?
Living in Nolensville, so I was making that hike,
man,
every day. So put quite a few miles on the truck.
I understand that. Well, Coach, I know preseason just finished up and we're just now getting into the season. Let's talk a little bit about how your preseason has been going for you up until the season has started.
Well, we've had some pretty good weather considering the elements at this time of year is not what I'm usual to. But we've had a lot of days where we're able to get on the field, which is important up here because when you get snow, and the ground saturated, it takes several days for it to dry out. And fortunately, we were on the field more so than we were last year. I know last year we were spending a lot of time in the gymnasium just trying to get some work done. So we're a little bit farther along than where we were last year this time.
Mm-hmm. Now, if I'm not mistaken, there's some kind of construction that had been going on up there at your place over the last few months or something?
We built a grandstand.
We did.
We had bleachers on both sides, but the view from the angles, if you've ever been there, because behind the backstop, it kind of slopes up to the backstop. It's very difficult to see. So our booster club did a tremendous job of raising enough money to build that. And fortunately, we got it up before the first game, and it's added a lot to our complex.
And then I think maybe last spring, sometimes some concession and some bathrooms were brought in, maybe?
That's correct. They we weren't able to utilize them last year.
Okay.
They actually did it in the summertime. So once we get the water turned on, we'll be ready to go. Right now, the weather's still a little chilly out there, but it's certainly going to add to the complex.
It will add to the complex. Well, let's talk about assistant coaches. Who's helping you this year? Any changes there?
No changes. I have three assistants. I have two assistants and a volunteer. And Danny Bourne is my assistant. He handles the pitchers and the weight program. Jason Pope, who was a graduate of Ravenwood High School, you may remember that name in the mid-2000s.
I do remember
this. He is also an assistant and also is our JV head coach. And our volunteer is Lanny McGowan, who has been coaching for over 50 years.
So, a lot of experience there.
A lot of experience.
Mm-hmm. Do a lot of your kids kind of go maybe like to a private hitting instructor and, you know, do that kind of stuff? Because I know there's like hitting facilities throughout the Middle Tennessee area.
You know, that's the one thing that's changed over the course of my career. Used to, there weren't any hitting facilities, so whatever coach said or whatever coach did, we did it that way. And I'm not saying that's always the best way, because I know there's a lot of instructors out there that are very good. But yeah, a lot of our guys go to different places. I know that Showtime over in Cool Springs is just around the corner, and our kids spend quite a bit of time over there.
Okay. Well, my my son and his wife, their grandbaby, she just turned one, and they're already talking about having another. So as a granddad, they're also wanting a boy, all right? So as a granddad, I would like to see a boy also. Do you think baseball is the best sport for a kid to get into?
Well, personally I do, because I love the game.
Uh-huh.
Now, I have three sons, and they played all different sports growing up. In fact, I have a senior who plays for me right now.
Okay.
I have a ninth grader who plays on the JV, and I have a sixth grader who plays at the middle school. So I really didn't direct them that way.
Okay.
I showed them all the sports out there and let them make those choices, and they all seemed to be a chip off the old block. They love the game, and but from a safety standpoint, when you look at all the things that are going on with football, it makes a parent scratch their head.
Sure.
And with the head injuries, I know my youngest plays football, but it's a great sport because you can play year round, and you can always work on your game. So I tend to push guys that direction.
Well, as a grandpa, I think I'm going to push my grandson, if I have one, into baseball, actually, because I think those guys probably make a little bit more money in the long run.
Oh,
the good
doubt.
Ones when it gets up
right,
there.
Right.
And their careers seem to be a little bit longer. Once you make it to the big leagues, they have a little bit longer careers. Well, let's talk a little bit about this year's team and how many seniors you have and a little bit about your starting lineup and that kind of thing, Coach.
We have a fairly experienced group, but we're a young group. We have 5 seniors, 12 juniors, and 2 sophomores. And we opened up Monday night, and we had 7 underclassmen on the field.
Hmm.
But some of those underclassmen have been playing for a little while. Bryce Denton is a junior who has started since he's in the 9th grade. He's a key hitter in our lineup. He's also one of our top pitchers. In fact, he's already been offered by University of Tennessee.
Oh.
And as a junior, that's pretty impressive.
That is impressive.
Our other 2 district starters as of now are Micah Katzer. He's a kid who moved here from Jacksonville a year ago. And he gave us close to 50 innings as a sophomore on the varsity. And he's a really good one, as well as Luke Yates. Luke Yates is another junior. And he got some time and pitched some big games last year for us last year. So our starting pitching is basically all juniors, but yet they've got some innings under their belt.
Mm-hmm.
We've got some other key guys like Corey Hayes is a senior who's starting to come along and get better, and he's starting to give us some innings, as well as Davis Elliott. He's another pitcher. Jeremy Thurman is coming off an arm injury from last year, and he's just getting back in the swing of things. So when you look at our pitching, we feel real comfortable where we're at. Now, in terms of our defense and our hitting, because we are so young, a lot of these guys were playing JV last year.
Mm-hmm.
So we really don't know how they're going to handle varsity pitching. Playing defense is one thing, but the difference between hitting a guy who's throwing at 70 miles an hour and 85 is a big difference. So we're still trying to feel our way out from a defensive standpoint, but Hagen Severance is a key guy back in our lineup. He was a 9th grader who started for us down the stretch last year. Guys like Daryl Freeman, who's really improved, he's playing center field for us, and we got a new player in Drew Haney, who is starting at shortstop as a sophomore. So we've got some pieces to the puzzle, and we have a lot of other guys that are going to play big parts. Right now, we just are trying to figure out who belongs where.
Okay. Coach, I want to back up a little bit and talk a little bit about this kid who's already been offered by UT. Mm-hmm. He's a junior. Come senior year, after I don't know what date, sometime, the pro baseball, they have a draft.
Mm-hmm.
If that kid got drafted, I mean, at what round would you give advice or – would a kid think about going to the pros right out of high school versus, going to the University of Tennessee or wherever he may end up? I mean, he may not end up at UT. But
Right. You say round, I say dollar sign. When I was in Orlando, we had quite a few kids get drafted that were late drafts, 30th round, 35th round. Most of those guys went on to college. But I did have one kid get drafted early in the 2nd round. And they had advisors, and he'd already committed to LSU, and this was back in, 2000.
Okay.
And they offered him $990,000. And my advice was, it's going to take me about 30 years teaching to make that kind of money.
So right.
My advice was, take the money and run. You can always go back to school. But, every family works a little bit differently. Everyone values education a little differently. Certainly I value it because I wouldn't be in education if not. But it's not every day you can get a $1 million paycheck written in your name. So he took the money and ran, and I thought it was the right decision.
Is he still there?
actually played 2 years of pro ball and got released.
Okay.
So, you know, who knows? I mean, you could say he would go to LSU and get better, but he may have never got drafted.
Sure.
So, Bryce is a special player. I think a lot of it's going to be based on, obviously, what round, like you said, but sometimes they will draft you a little bit lower and offer you more money. In other words, sometimes you'll see a high school kid get drafted in the seventh or eighth round, but they'll try to give you second or third round money just to get you to sign the dotted line.
Okay, that's interesting. Are pro scouts, are there any limitations for them having communication with the kid and the parents? To a high school kid, you know, a kid that's made that decision, well, I'm going to college or I'm going to go.
Right.
Yeah.
They question them. I mean, the top prospects have to do questionnaires, and if you're going to be a top pick, they're going to bring you in and they're going to do what they do at the NFL Combine. They're going to quiz you and ask a lot of questions.
They'll probably find out, too, if that kid was really interested in going to college. I mean, during that may depend on what round he gets drafted to.
Right.
He said, so just an example, Coach, what kind of first-round money may come out there to the big dogs in?
Right now, like I said, second-round money was almost $1 million 14 years ago. You're talking $2-3 million
on
first-round money. So
that's a lot to wave in front of a high school kid,
right,
isn't it?
It's pretty significant, yeah.
Oh, man. Well, I hope that kid gets an opportunity to say no or yay.
Right.
When it comes time for him to get there. Of course, you've got a lot of baseball you want to get out of him before he gets to that point. Well, at this level, I'm sure, and mostly every level, pitching is the key if you're going to, you know, make it in the district tournament and the state tournament. And so you feel like that may be one of your strengths this year?
I think so. It's still too early to tell. You know, I have a lot of trust in our pitching staff, but yet they're 16-year-old kids.
Sure.
So, you know, we don't know how they're going to respond to pressure situations. Granted, they do have experience. The big thing that I've learned over the years is that 16, 17, 18-year-old kids obviously aren't fully mature, and whenever there's adversity and things aren't going their way, sometimes they'll do things that are abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
So over time, I think we'll get a better indication of where we're at, but I really like our pitching staff.
Mm-hmm. Well, Coach, let's back up a little bit further. When you do tryouts, I know that the season kind of starts like the first week of February, or 15th of February 15th, that week or something like that, basically?
It's right around that time, yeah.
Okay. And say 50 kids come out. You don't keep all 50.
No.
No.
No, we had 53 come out this
year.
We have JV varsity, we have 37.
Okay.
So we try to give everyone a full week. I don't believe in a one-day tryout or a two-day tryout. I like to give them as many looks as possible.
Okay.
And what's difficult is the weather. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times we're analyzing a pitcher and he's pitching in 28-degree weather, which isn't ideal for a pitcher or a hitter.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that's what we're doing. That's the elements. That's what we deal with. Now, I know a lot of high schools will do their tryouts in the prior summer so they can have that taken care of. I would rather wait because a lot of times there's a lot of maturation between the summer and the spring. You look at 9th and 10th graders, some of them hit a growth spurt and they look like different kids 6 months later. So that's the reason I wait until February to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But it is a little bit more difficult because of the weather and the numbers.
Mm-hmm. So I think pitching, that part of it I would understand, but if a kid's not a pitcher, are you kind of looking maybe like the size of the kid or hand-eye coordination of the kid or just athletic ability overall? Or what other kind of factors would you know, come into play that you look for as a coach?
Well, you know, character's big on my part.
Okay.
A lot of times, you know, we start training in the fall in terms of weightlifting and speed training and the things that we're able to do within the rules. And the positive is I get to know these kids a little bit better. And you get to find out who's going to show up at 5:45 in the morning and lift weights. So you sense who's hungry and who just wants to be on the team.
Mm-hmm.
And so in terms of character, that's critical, making sure they have their grades and they're good citizens around campus and so forth. But in terms of the player itself, you know, like any other sport, you're looking for athletes, you're looking for kids who can run, you're looking for kids who are strong. But baseball is a little different in that you don't have to necessarily be a real strong kid or a fast kid to be a good baseball player. So you have to, it's hard to really pinpoint it. I think that, you know, generally speaking, after I see a kid swing the bat four or five times or make three or four throws, you generally have a feel if they have any skill at that position.
Mm-hmm. Well, that kind of brought up another question for me. Your kids working out that early in the morning, getting them all together. Oh, do you have any kids that play other sports? That
very few. We have a handful of kids who play football, who obviously are excused from fall workouts because they're with the football team. But we didn't have any basketball kids this year.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of one sport kids. We don't direct them that way. We, you know, I tell them to play whatever they want to play, but it's getting so competitive that a lot of kids are starting to narrow things down to just one sport.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike your day and my day,
that's
where
for
you, you played all kinds of sports, whatever season it was you played.
Right, exactly right. And so at what age should dads start their kids now playing, I mean, the baseball or teaching them the right way to, I don't know if there's a right way to hold a bat or not, or choking up like Barry Bonds did, or not choking up, or, you know, what age should we start them and we don't burn them out?
Well, you know, I just started throwing the ball around with my kids when they were five or six and just kind of let them, you know, if they wanted to go out in the yard and swing the bat, we'd get a wiffle ball and a wiffle ball bat, and we just go out there and have fun. I just let them have fun. I really didn't do any teaching until they were probably 8 or 9 years old. Maybe slight corrections, like, you know, here's how you stand or here's how you throw, and we make those kind of adjustments, but for the most part, I just wanted them to have fun. And then if they're 8 or 9 and started getting more serious, then you can focus more on the mechanics. I think things like teaching the mechanics of hitting, especially at a real, real young age, you've got to let a kid, you got to find out what they do naturally well. Mm-hmm. And then go from there. And if they don't do it naturally well, then you can kind of bend them and mold them the way you want, or at least try to. But it's a tough skill to master.
Mm. Well, I remember with my youngest son, I had a kind of little rule, me and mom, about the boys. We'll let you play two sports when you're young, but, you know, you're going to take a season off and rest. I don't care which two you play. And my youngest one took, and he wanted to start with the baseball. And he loved baseball. One was T-ball, and it was a, you know, getting hit the ball and all that kind of stuff. And then when he moved up to that next age group, I couldn't remember what, if it was the 7 years old or the 8 year old, they were letting the kids pitch, and the game became a 7-run game, and they pitchers were walking every kid around the bases, and he would come home and said, "Daddy, this is so boring. Yeah. You know, I want to quit." I said, "No, you're playing out this year." And I said, "Next year, if you don't want to go out, that's fine, but you're playing," and he never went back out for baseball.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I have a problem with the kid pitch at that age. I'm not around it young enough other than me putting eyeballs on my kids. I don't think the kids should pitch to each other until they're 10. Now, some coaches would disagree with that, but I just sat through too many 8-, 9-year-old games that take, you know, an eternity, or if they play a time limit, which is an hour and a half, they get through two innings and it's a walk-a-thon.
Exactly.
So I'd rather see the coaches pitch it and let the kids hit it and field it and work on those mechanics.
Yeah. Well, Coach, as far as you talked a little bit about the weight room and how important it is for you and your program, I'm going to throw some things to you here right now and get your opinion, okay?
Okay.
Bunt or swing away?
Bunt.
You gonna bunt it every time?
not every time, but it's critical that you're able to move runners.
Uh-huh.
We talked about it last year that with the BB Corps bats, there aren't nearly as many home runs. You know, I follow Vanderbilt closely. They're 17-2, I believe, and they're ranked top 5 of the nation. And I think they've hit 5 home runs this year after 19 games.
Yeah.
We use the same bats they use. So at the high school level, there aren't going to be nearly as many home runs. So, again, when I say bunt, I'm talking about moving runners, getting them in scoring position, and putting the ball in play and putting pressure on the defense.
Okay. Here's another one. Read and react or steal and disrupt?
Steal and disrupt. Pressure on the defense. Pressure on the defense. Now, the higher you go, obviously the game gets faster and the players are more skilled.
Mm-hmm.
But at this level, I think that when you apply more pressure on defenses, they're going to make more mistakes. Now, I'll say this, that there's probably fans that think I'm crazy because we get more guys thrown out on the bases than anyone being aggressive. But at the same time, when they step on home plate, when we're aggressive, I usually don't get patted on the back. I don't expect to, but when you get a guy thrown out at the plate or get caught stealing, or, you know, it's the nature of the game that, you know, you've got to be aggressive.
Right.
You're going to get guys thrown out, but I'd rather be aggressive than be tentative.
Okay. One more of these type of questions. College or pro?
College.
Okay.
Education should be first. You know, pro is way down the line. The odds of making it are just, you know, we have kids on our team that want to play pro baseball, mm-hmm. and I tell them, go for it. You know, make me proud. Mm-hmm. Make the big bucks. Just make sure you get me some box seats when you get to the World Series.
That's right.
But,
as far as you watching the game, you'd rather watch a college
I'd rather watch a college game.
Okay.
Just because, you know, I enjoy watching Vanderbilt. I just think it's played a little bit more like the high school game. The pro game, they never bunt. They don't steal like they used to. It's more get up to the bat and play for the long ball.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoy seeing the home run ball, don't get me wrong, but I just like the pace and the speed of the college game versus the pro game.
Okay. Well, let's talk a little bit about District 11 AAA. Mm-hmm. Who's the team to beat this year?
Well, you know, that's a good question. You know, we've added two teams. We added Summit this year. We also have added Dixon County, and Hillsborough went elsewhere. So,
I think the district got tougher, Coach.
District's tough. We've got seven teams in our district, and, you know, you can make a case for each and every one of them. Brentwood is always very good. Centennial made a great run last year. They beat us in the district championship.
And, okay.
And if I'm not mistaken, they won a game or two, and they may have won the sub-state. I'm not sure. But mm-hmm. they got hot, and they did a great job over there. Independence is always good. Franklin is always good. The unknowns at this point are Dixon County. I don't know a whole lot about them, but Summit is growing in population over there, and they got off to a good start this week. They took two out of three from Franklin. So, you know, it could be anybody. It's all about who gets hot at the end of the season.
Okay, and we'll talk a little bit about that, your district schedule, on how you guys do it.
Well, it's tough because you play every team three times, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday.
Okay.
So,
now, who voted on that?
We all voted, and there was really no way around that. Some of us wanted two games, some wanted three. We settled on a three-game series, which means we play 18 district games, which is quite a grind. It started on opening day. Now, fortunately for Ravenwood, we drew a bye, but everyone else was playing district games on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday this week. So, we don't start our district until next week because we drew the bye, but it's a long season, 18 games. And the number one seed, whoever wins the regular season, gets a bid to the tournament. So,
no, I like that.
It means something.
Yeah, I like that. It rewards that team who won the regular season district championship. I like that part of it. So, outside of Ravenwood Raptors, that number one team could be any of those other six teams, you think?
I think it's up for grabs. It would be too hard for me. I haven't seen Summit up close, and I haven't seen Dixon County up close.
Mm-hmm.
I just know that traditionally, when you look at Franklin and Independence and Centennial and Brentwood, they're always good.
Mm-hmm.
The game's not played on paper. You know, right. I can look at paper and say, well, they lost these guys. I don't know what they have coming up. I don't know what the chemistry's like. I just know that on any given week, anybody can beat anybody in a given series. Mm-hmm. So,
backing up to last year, who won the district regular season last year, Coach?
Brentwood won the regular season.
Okay.
We played Centennial for the district championship, and okay. they beat us.
Okay. So that means Brentwood and Centennial might
have advanced. That's
correct. Okay. All right. Of course, you probably didn't like that rule then when you were
playing. Well, in fact, I mean, as I look back at it, yeah. They didn't have that rule in Florida.
Okay.
Okay, so you could be the one seed. It was the top two teams
right.
who advanced. So
exactly.
I didn't like it back then. Mm-hmm. Last year, I certainly didn't like the situation because we had to win it. And,
right.
We were in the driver's seat, but Centennial outplayed us.
All right, Coach. Baseball 101.
Okay.
What is the dead GM strike zone anyway? I mean, I get confused. Does it vary with the official?
Yeah, it does. Umpire? It does. Every.
What's it supposed to be, Coach?
Well, I'd like to say kneecaps to just under the armpits.
Okay.
You know, we had a game the other night, and not a bad umpire, but he was coming off college games. So the strike zone was shrunk up a little bit, and the result was there were about 15 walks between the two games, between the two teams. So, and we had control pitchers. Now, they weren't on top of their game, but the point is that you've got to really get a read early in the game because we get a lot of different types of umpires who have big zones, small zones. No one really plays it by the book.
Okay.
So, but it should be just below the armpit to the knees.
Uh-huh. How much leeway is there for conversation between a coach and an umpire in situations like that?
In terms of questioning balls and strikes?
Yes.
Well, out loud you're not supposed
okay.
to. You know, in between innings, I think we all try to, you know, speak to them as we pass by.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe try to get some points on our side or ask how much they're giving on the outside or inside corner. But they all vary. It's tough. A lot of times I won't go to the umpire. I'll talk to our catcher about where the ball is ending up in the mitt. And but, you know, it's tough. They've got a tough job. And generally speaking, you know, their students and parents right on top of them, and they have to deal with that as well. So it's not an easy job.
Mm-hmm. Very briefly, Coach, infield fly rule. Tell us how that has to be. We have 1 minute.
First and second, or bases loaded, pop up to the infield, less than two outs, batter's automatically out, okay? Now, when they call infield fly rule, it's got to be a fair ball, and it's got to be a ball that the umpire feels like an infielder can camp under.
Okay.
In other words, draw a bead on it. It happened the other night. We were playing, and the Denton kid was playing third, and he dropped it on purpose so he could step on third and throw to first, but they had called the infield fly rule,
right.
So that didn't fly, but that's what it is.
Well, Coach, thank you so much for joining us, and best of luck this year, and stay healthy, and hopefully we'll see you in the state championships.
Thanks for having me.
All right. Thank you for joining us for this segment of the Williamson County Sports Connection. I'm Jack Daniels, your host.
Children just seem to be born leaders. They have the natural ability and confidence that just makes other people want to work with them. But all children can become leaders, and here are a few things you can try to develop the leadership potential for your child. First, watch leaders in the news and talk about what makes them good at leading. Model leadership for your child through your own involvement in school, business, or community activities. Teach your child to look at things from other people's points of view, because good leaders can see the world from different perspectives. Look for opportunities for your child to be involved in leadership activities through church, clubs, scouts, or athletic teams. Hold family meetings and let your child take turns being in charge. Now remember, don't pressure your child beyond his ability. If he seems to be unhappy or stressed, just relax and lighten up and try again when he's ready. Remember, stay connected. You're the vital link in your child's school success. I'm Joan Tidwell, and this is Parent Connection.